Actually, not.
Just in the
nick of time.
Absolutely. All right, ready, folks?
Good to go.
All right, we're going to call tonight's business to order. Before the Zoning Board of Appeals, I'm David Trinolo. I'm acting as chair tonight while our chairman is otherwise disposed. We have three cases on our agenda tonight. I'm going to act as chair for the first two, and then I'm going to step down from the third case, and Mr. Cowett is going to chair that one. So we'll hear the first two cases, and then we'll hear the third after I've gone. The first case on the agenda tonight is case 16-03, and I'm going to go ahead and I'll read the legal notice, and then we'll get started. The Zoning Board of Appeals will hold a public hearing in the Selectman's Meeting Room at the Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, on Thursday, April 7th, 7 p.m., on the petition of Frank, John, and Teresa A. Wiggins, who seek an accessory apartment special permit under sections 532 and 5472 of the zoning bylaws, in order to construct a detached accessory building for use as an accessory apartment as per plans submitted on the property located at 61 Terrace Park in Reading, Massachusetts. All of the local authorities that needed to get notice, as well as the abutters that needed to get notice, have been noticed. Any testimony taken before the board tonight is taken under oath, so any parties for case 16-03 who feel that they're going to present any testimony tonight, please raise your right hand and be sworn. The testimony you propose to give before this board tonight will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. The response is, I will. Thank you. Brad, I guess you're going to be the presenter tonight. Please, the floor is yours.
Thank you. My name is Brad Latham. I'm the attorney for the applicant. With me this evening are, as you've indicated, the legal notice, Frank and Teresa Wiggins, who are sitting here with Teresa's parents. The hope is that Teresa's parents can live in the home that they'd like to build for them on their property. The property is 61 Terrace Park. It's in the S20 zoning district. The lot is over twice the zoning required size of 51,481 square feet. The objective is to construct an attractive freestanding building that meets the criteria of the zoning bylaw. And I'd like to, if I could, go through the criteria and check it off. And that's looking through 5473 performance standards. Mm-hmm. The first standard is that only one accessory apartment may exist on a lot, and we're only looking for one. The accessory apartment must be freestanding in the sense that it has its own bath facilities and kitchen, and it does, as you can see from the plan that was submitted with you. We've shown the interior on this plan, which is also required, and the exterior elevation drawings. Paragraph B, it says the accessory apartment can occupy more than one-third of the gross floor area of the principal single-family dwelling. In actuality, it's not within the single-family. I think this language came back when it could only be within the building itself. But nevertheless, it meets that criteria. The principal residence, if you exclude the areas that the bylaw says to exclude, is 3,416 square feet. That would mean mathematically that the accessory apartment could be 1,139 square feet. Using the same criteria, what's excluded from the calculation, the accessory apartment here is 815 square feet. So that's the addressing that one element, if it's applicable. Secondly, there are minimum and maximum sizes. It says it can't be less than 400 square feet, and this is the net floor area, or can't be more than 750 net square feet. This project, this proposal is 620 net square feet, so it falls within the criteria of the zoning bylaw. The next criteria in C is that at least one of the owners must live either in the principal residence or the accessory apartment. The Wiggins intend to continue to live in a home with her parents living in the accessory apartment, so that criteria would be met. And then any modifications, they talk about the appearance, and again, I think D, E, and F all anticipate an accessory apartment within the main building, but I'll go through them. And it says you can't have a modification made to the principal single-family dwelling that changes its appearance from being a single-family. There's no change taking place in the principal dwelling. All stairs to the primary entrance to an accessory apartment located on the second or third floor must meet certain criteria. There's no, that doesn't apply either. The accessory apartment's not on the second or third floor of the principal building. F, when two or more entrances already exist in the front facade of the principal building, you can't modify them again. No modification is proposed to the principal structure. G, all motor vehicles that are going to park in the site must park off street in designated driveway areas. We have one driveway, and you can see there's a sub-driveway off of that to serve the new structures. So in essence, that criteria will be met. It will not have any adverse effect on abutting property. If you had occasion to go by, you can see that this is a large lot. It's heavily wooded on both sides, so they have no impact upon the abutters with reference to the parking. You have probably one loading vehicle to go with the accessory use. And then it says that both the principal dwelling and the accessory apartment must be connected to public water and sanitary sewer, and that is the intention here. And the accessory apartment may not have more than three people in occupancy. Here, the envisionment would be to have two, Teresa's mother and father. And then the last J deals with carriage house, which is not the case here. And then K deals with waivers, which are not being requested. So we believe, if I may, with due respect, that we meet the standards of the bylaw, and we request that the board issue a special permit. And I'm sure the Wiggins or our parents will be more than happy to see any questions that the board may have. Thank you.
Thank you. Typically, the next step in the process is that we'll gather some commentary and or questions from board members. Then we'll have an opportunity for the public to ask questions, have any commentary, and then following that, we will make our deliberations or make some determinations. Prior to asking the board members to comment, I'd like to read into the record the comments of the building inspector, Glenn Redmond, regarding this case. He submitted them in lieu of his appearance, and I'm going to read them into the record. Case 1603 at 61 Terrace Park is an application for a detached accessory apartment and requires a special permit from the ZBA. The proposal is for a 24 by 34 structure, one story high in height with one 13 foot 6 inch by 8 foot 2 inch screen porch and a 12 foot 6 inch by 24 foot carport as indicated on the construction plans. I have reviewed the proposal and everything appears to meet the requirements of the bylaws in the town of Reading. All right, next we will invite board commentary, and we'll start with Kathy.
You know, I appreciate you going through the different parts of the requirement, and right now I really don't have any specific questions.
John.
Just a couple of questions. I initially had a question on the frontage aspect of it, but I kind of guess I've resolved that somewhat. But I do have a question on a couple of other things regarding the frontage. I don't see a driveway other than the driveway to the new detached in-law apartment. There's no driveway that apparently is going to the main house.
The existing driveway stays there, and they're just going to have a spur off to have a parking area and a driveway area for the.
Well, according to the plan here, you're building the detached in-law apartment. Detached in-law structure on top of the driveway with the screen porch jutting out into the what exists as the driveway right now. So,
is the driveway moving?
Yeah.
It's not really, can I approach it?
Yeah. This is what appears
here. That's the driveway.
This is the driveway.
That's the driveway.
Coming off the cul-de-sac.
Right.
Okay. Okay, that was one of the questions I have. Second question was the location of the new detached structure on the property. Particular reason why it's down basically at the cul-de-sac?
It seemed the most appropriate place to do it. I mean, there's some wetlands behind the house, so there's some restrictions as far as where it could be placed. And that seemed to be the ideal location to have it. It meets the zoning criteria, and I hope that would be acceptable. Trying not to disturb any wooded area as well. But there are wetlands, if I may, on the southerly, in the southerly direction.
Just to clarify, it's conservation land that's behind the house, not wetlands, because it goes uphill.
Right, good point.
And there is a lot of ledge to up the driveway, so because of the contour of the land, it was very hard to get. We originally first tried to get it up farther up the driveway, but it looks like the ledge caused that to be a problem.
Okay. Did you have to appear before conservation in lieu of your proposal because of the wetland?
The initial thought was it probably was not jurisdictional, but once if we are successful here, then there'd probably be a meeting with the conservation administrator to get this done.
In the design of the unit, I noticed that there does not seem to be any mechanical room for services such as heat, water, electrical. There's no stairs to the basement, which is the two-car garage. Are we talking about putting that stuff in later? Or are we looking to put that in above the first floor? That's just a question that I have. I mean, that's got nothing to do with the zoning aspect of it, but it does in terms of the square footage that you're using for the accessory apartment.
The plan is to put the utilities in the garage. It's like there's a drawing that an architect had that did square off a little bit of space for that in the garage.
I mean, there's plenty of room in the garage to do that.
Right.
I just didn't show anything on the plan, so I didn't know how that was going to go.
We had actually asked the conceptual.
All right, between the building inspector and you guys, if the board okays it. The height of the new structure, I was concerned because of when you look forward, it appears that you could go up to 35 feet, but in reality, according to section 5.51 of the zoning bylaws, because it's a accessory structure, you can only go up one story. So if you're not counting the, which we're not counting the garage, one story, it can only be one story high. So it'll never reach 35 feet. My concern would be that when Zach committee made the changes to the bylaws, we were expecting some other changes to be made too, and one of the biggest ones is comparing gross square footage of the principal residence to net square footage of the accessory apartment, which creates all kinds of problems because you can eliminate bathrooms, anything that's not residential and not livable areas, closets, hallways, stairways. So it creates a major problem. I am not really a big supporter of the new bylaw for the detached, because in essence, it allows for two principal residences on the same lot, which we don't have here in Reading. But by looking at this, if this were on a main drag, you could see, it would appear that you have two principal residences, even though one is principal and one is accessory. But that's another issue, but not germane to what we're discussing here in terms of the bylaw. So I have a number of things that I'm concerned about, but according to your calculations, I know that they were very carefully reviewed. I mean, I think you sat with a building inspector to look at some of those calculations, so it didn't come out the same way I did, but it's still in the same ballpark, so I'm not going to question the numbers, because they're within the same area. Those are my concerns. Those are my comments or questions right now.
Thanks, John. Si?
I have no disagreement with what you had presented, Brad. The only thing that I would comment on is that in the package that was submitted, there are architectural drawings, sheets 1 through 7. And I guess I'd like to have someone explain to me the relevance of sheets 4 through 7 to what you're asking for tonight, okay? I can see where sheets 1, 2, and 3 directly apply to this, but what's the relevance of 4 through 7?
I asked him to show the existing principal residence and therefore the calculation of area in
okay.
case that became germane. My personal feeling was that if you look at the bylaw, that because the accessory building is not within the principal building, that first calculation doesn't apply, but for safety's sake, I asked him to show it. And that's why I said.
Okay. So, question I have.
Thank you, Si. Eric?
No comments.
Nick?
I don't have any comments.
All right. One of my thoughts is perhaps that we may want to condition any motion that we make on CONCOM, further CONCOM approval. I'll leave that up to board discussion. You know, one of the things that we should start, and again, we don't get many of these since the new bylaw had been codified and passed as a detached building, but when we rewrote the town zoning bylaw, we did specifically carve out an area for accessory apartments to be built in accessory structures, and we also added an accessory building or structure section to the bylaw, which is codified under 551. And I think the granting authority under 551, where this is an existing an accessory structure to be built, working under 551A, where it says in relevant part, accessory buildings or structures located within a required yard shall be limited to one story. We have that here. And accessory buildings may be used for accessory apartments only as permitted pursuant to 547, which were the criteria that Brad went through. But if you read further, no accessory or structure in part B, no accessory structure or building may have a footprint larger than 600 square feet or 25% of the gross floor area. Presents a little bit of a conflict, if you will, but I think we resolve that conflict by proceeding under 551A that says you can have an accessory building with an accessory apartment pursuant to 547. So I'm going to proceed tonight, or ask the board to proceed tonight, under 551A, and we may want to include in any motion a reference to 551A, which is ultimately the enabling relevant portion of the bylaw that then refers back to 547. I don't have any other questions or commentary. It seems like a fairly straightforward application. It's one of the reasons why we amended the bylaw to include this allowance, if you will, or this process for the addition of accessory apartments in new structures, accessory buildings. So I have nothing further. At this point, I'm going to open the hearing up to any public comment. If there are any members of the public present that would like to speak on behalf, against, or about the petition, please rise, identify yourself, your name, by name and address, and address the board. Going once. Okay, hearing none, we're going to close the public portion of the hearing. And is there any more comment from the board or questions from the board at this time?
There is one other issue, and that goes back to section 627. And that, I think, was modified in the recodification. I 6271, I guess it is, was originally, there could be no more than one principal building erected on a single lot. I believe that was corrected, and the word principal was added, so that you could do that. Again, this allows for more than one, actually two, residential structures on the same lot.
Right, one being principal, one being accessory.
Exactly.
Yep. All right, if the board is satisfied, I'll entertain a motion from a member regarding the case at hand. Anybody want to volunteer, or we'll draw straws, or who'd like to make a motion?
Just
go ahead,
the one question I had is, are we going to condition upon approval by conservation or no?
Well, make your motion.
Okay.
And if you feel like you want to add that condition to it, we certainly will have a comment. And if the board doesn't feel like we want to do a friendly amendment or otherwise, we'll proceed that way. Everybody agree with that?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
I move to approve the petition of Frank, John, and Teresa Wiggins, who seek an accessory apartment special permit under sections 5.32, 5.51A, and 5.47.2 of the zoning bylaws in order to construct a detached accessory building for use as an accessory apartment as per the plan submitted on the property located at 61 Terrace Park in Reading, Massachusetts. I'd like to reference the certified plot plan, which is dated February 8th, 2016. And prepared by Vineyard Engineering and Environmental Services, 400 West Cummings Park, Suite 4800, Woburn, Mass. It is stamped by James J. Abel, professional land surveyor. I'd also like to reference some architectural plans that were submitted. They were prepared by Phoenix Architects, Wakefield, Massachusetts. It's like they're dated. Oh yeah, February 9th, 2016, pages 1 to 6.
1 to 7, I think.
Excuse me?
1 to 7.
Oh, 1 to 7.
It's only got six pages.
Only got six.
Maybe I made one all by myself.
You're absolutely right.
I'll take that one.
I think the architectural plans are really, as you had mentioned, Si, the one.
The ones that truly apply.
1 through 3.
Yeah.
1 through 3. The 4 through 6 only applies to the calculations.
Yeah.
I
mean, I don't have a problem putting them in, but I don't think they're needed.
Okay.
That's kind of belt and suspenders.
Yeah.
Either way, it's fine.
Do we put the usual conditions on these? The
I think we would, yeah.
These new structures, we would have to.
Yep.
I'd also like to impose the condition that the petitioner shall submit to the building inspector a certified plot plan of the proposed construction and proposed foundation plans prior to the issuance of a foundation permit for the work. The petitioner's final construction plans for the new structure shall be submitted to the building inspector along with the as-built foundation plans prior to the issuance of the building permit. And and the as-built plan showing the completed construction shall be submitted to the building inspector immediately after the work is completed and prior to the issuance of the occupancy permit.
Could we add the condition with the approval of the CPDC or with a condition of conservation approving the location of the structure?
If I may, I'm sorry, could that be, if in fact it's jurisdictional, because if they don't have jurisdiction, we want to have to...
Well, that's true.
If necessary?
Okay.
Would that be sufficient if we add if necessary?
So with the condition of approval by conservation?
If necessary.
If necessary.
If necessary.
If necessary, okay.
I second that motion.
Okay.
Right, we have a motion, we have a second.
Second.
And do we have any further discussion by the members of the board regarding the form or content of the motion? Hearing none, we'll put it to a vote. All those in favor? All those opposed? Abstaining?
Abstaining.
So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in favor, 0 opposed, 1 abstention. The permit is granted.
Thank you very much for your time.
Actually, you only had 5 people voting.
Yeah, so it's 4 in favor and 1 abstain.
Oh, actually, yeah.
Oh, okay.
The 5 voting members of these 5 right here, not Nick.
You're not an associate member?
Yeah.
I guess I am, but...
There's a voting member tonight.
Well, don't we let all of the members vote? They're here. We only need 5?
5.
So
okay.
I'm happy to alternate with Nick, though. I don't think I have any seniority as associate member.
So, that's right. Since we've had Nick, it changed things around a little bit. So the vote will, the votes that count will be 1, 2, 3, 4 in favor.
4-0.
0 abstaining. 0 against, 1 abstaining. The permit is still granted. Thanks very much, folks. So I'm going to, I'll stamp your plans for you, Brad. I have a copy right here. I can hand to you. We have 14 days to write it up. An appeal period will run. You know,
the change, though.
Okay.
I'll tell you what, you can hang on to this.
Great, thanks.
There you go, sir. Thank you. You too. Thank you, folks.
Thank you.
Kathy will write that up. I guess probably send it to.
Oh yeah.
And send it out. Send it out
right
to the whole board.
Mm-hmm.
And if Bob is. Yeah, I guess send it to me then and I'll sign it. Yeah. Yeah, I suppose you're right. Darn it. I hate telling him that he's right. All right, the next case we're here for tonight is case 1604. The notice into the record. Zoning Board of Appeals will hold a public hearing in the Selectman's Meeting Room at Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, on Thursday, April 7th, 2016, at 7 p.m. on the petition of Lee and Christine Sullivan, who seek a special permit under Section 732 of the zoning bylaws in order to construct a front entrance with a roof over a 4.2 feet by 9.2 feet. As per a plan on the property located at 24 Corey Lane, Reading, Massachusetts. Same as before, all the butters and local and regional authorities have been notified. And anybody wishing to speak in favor of this case, please rise your right hand so you can be sworn. All testimony given before this board is to the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. The answer is I do.
You do.
I will. All right, and who's going to speak on behalf of case 1604?
I am. Ed Hooksepia, PH Construction Company, and I'm just representing the owners, Lee and Christine Sullivan. The owners wish to expand an existing front entry landing 2 feet 7 inches in width only. There's no change in depth. We also want to construct a covered roof with open sides supported by two architectural columns over the landing area on the wall. Because of the proximity to wetlands, we were granted prior to this hearing the NIAP project permit and conservation. That's about it.
That's it?
Yeah.
Okay. Great, thank you very much. Please be available for any board commentary. Now we will open up the case to comments or questions by board members, and we'll start on the opposite side. Nick, do you have any questions or comments regarding the case?
I don't have any.
Okay. Eric?
Glenn's comment. It seems like the setback is going to be the same 16.6 feet, so it doesn't appear as though you're adding to it. It looks like you're falling under that exception that the special permit allows for. And the, I guess, threshold to meet is whether or not that alteration or change is substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood. I think it's a great addition, it looks terrific. So I have no objection to the project.
Thank you. Si?
Well, I know in the rejection letter that the building inspector sent you, he indicated at the time that he was not sure whether a variance was going to be required. And I might say the same thing. I'm not sure either. But I would echo Eric's comment. I took a ride by the property, and I think what you want to do really enhances the appearance of the house. It really does. And you know, from that standpoint, it looks great. So I guess I'd maybe just open up a discussion around the board, and of course, if I'm looking at this thing, as to whether anyone on the board feels that we need that a variance is needed or not, because we are basically covering up, roofing up that entryway. And I know in the past we've talked about that and got into a variance, non-variance discussion.
Yeah, I mean, this is a sort of a portico case, you know, that we've listened to and heard many times.
My thought on that, I have the same question, Si, on that. And I saw that the date of the application, I don't have the date that Glenn denied it, but it looks like they revised it on February 5th afterwards. Hmm. So taking that together with Glenn's comments about, I guess, it appears as though he's made a finding that it's not going to be any sort of setback issue. So I just assumed that based on Glenn's comment, but you're right. I mean, we should probably have that discussion.
And all your comments for now, you'll hold off until we have further discussion.
Other thoughts are on the other side of the table.
Great.
Thank you, sir. Could I comment on that?
Sure.
So I did speak with Glenn about that. Originally, his denial letter was not really sure if it should be a variance or a special permit. And then upon further discussions with him, he considered that the fact that it's not becoming any greater, into, you know, it's not expanding any more into the setback, it's not becoming closer to the street, that it's just in width. He felt that under that circumstance, it was speaking a special permit. That was the last conversation I had with him. So that helps.
John?
having gone by the house, I see that, when I'm talking to the building inspector, that a special, that a building permit had been issued, but a provisional one. So that which is not included in that is the front entrance. I would probably, the way I look at it is, when the property, when the house was built, I forget what the view was, but anyways, when the house was built, the setback was 20 feet. The stoop, which was the 4x6, is not, has not been considered to be part of the setback requirement. So it doesn't, it does not fall in what they call the front yard setback. However, when you cover it, it does in actuality come, even though you're extending it. You're extending it 2 feet to either side. And to me, it's creeping. The platform, or whatever you want to call it, the stoop, is not considered to be part of the setback. It's not in the front yard setback. But when you cover it, it is back in the stoop. It does become part of the setback. That's how the building inspector has done this before. I'm not going to question how he found, you know, why he's finding it this way, particularly. But if the board does go through with the special permit under 732, I would suggest we put a condition on there that there can be no additional platforms put on, and that the porches or the entries can never be enclosed. Only because that then becomes a becomes a variance issue down the road. I mean, otherwise, everybody else on Corey Lane and or in that development could do the same thing. In which case, the stoop then becomes part of the setback, and you're going to say, I built a brand new house and I was able to set it back 16.6 feet instead of the 20 feet, so I'm not held by the same standards that everybody else in town is held. So that's the only concern that I would have.
Okay, we'll note that. Kathy?
Yeah, I have nothing to add to that, and I will say, Eric, I looked at it similar to the way you had, but yeah, I have nothing to add.
All right, as I alluded to a little bit ago, we've had this discussion, we've had several of these similar types of cases come before the board in the past where, you know, I call them portico cases, where I don't know that we've had one where the stoop was expanded, just that it was covered.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's the difference.
And so so it is a little bit different in that regard, and I can see why that might have raised some question marks regarding whether or not this is a variance case or not. But I think we, as a board, might consider, and before we do, consider the building inspector's commentary regarding this case, and I'm going to go ahead and read that into the record once I find it. Got it right here. Case 1604, this is from Glenn Redmond, the building inspector, 24 Corey Lane. This application is to add a front entry with a roof over 9 feet 2 inches by 4 feet 2 inches with a front setback of 16.6 feet. The existing front platform is 6 by 4 feet 2 inches with the same front setback of 16.6 feet. A special permit is required under section 512 and 732 for this proposal. I do not have any concerns with this proposal. And that's the feeling of the building inspector. Sai, let me hear your thoughts a little bit more about why you question, your feeling why perhaps a variance might be.
Well, the only thing that went through my mind is that you're covering up the stoop. And then, as you say, we've had those discussions in the past, okay? I mean, the expansion of the stoop didn't bother me. It's just putting a cover on it, which you could infer that becomes part of the structure, okay? we can argue that point. But as Eric said, I think, you know, Glenn started down the same direction, it sounds like, but in the course of interactions with the petitioner and so forth, he's come to the conclusion that in this particular case, it's okay. Right? And as such, I probably would have no problem, I wouldn't object or disagree with him. So I would lean to the side of saying I would go without a variance requirement at this point in time.
Well, thinking back with my photographic memory to the, to the other cases similar to this that we've handled, I think we've always treated them as special permit cases. I don't think we've ever treated it, because it was being covered, I don't think we've ever treated it as a variance case. I know the expansion of it perhaps takes it into a, could be argued that we take it into a different realm, but
the enclosure of it definitely.
Oh, if it was a vestibule, we'd be having a different conversation altogether.
Right.
But where it's open and just covered, you know, we've had cases where people come forth with an existing platform that gets really icy, and they've asked to put a portico up so that they can reroute the drainage away from the front steps so they don't slip and fall. So. I can remember that case in particular that we treated it as a special permit. And excuse me, I don't think this is all that different from that.
Most of those other properties were ones that were built either prior to zoning or right after zoning came in. This was built so that the 20 feet included, and I'm sure it was conservation impacted. And that's why we have perhaps this situation now. But I think the big difference is when you increase the size of the stoop is now becoming part of the house. So there's the question of whether it is a variance or a special permit. However, because of the neighborhood in which it is located, that appears to be the only house that is in that particular situation. I mean, I didn't walk down all the homes in the in that section that were built off of Dividence Road, but I would say the majority are, do conform in every respect, especially in the front yard setback. Therefore, I think because it's no more of a detriment to the neighborhood in a situation like this, and in fact, you're improving the, I'll say, curb appeal again, which is a major issue according to the ZAC committee, that this would be more appropriate, but I still would like to see whoever makes the motion, and I'm not making the motion, that we do a condition indicating that the porch could never be covered or an additional stoop be added.
I would add, too, that we also probably consider whether or not there's an increase in the existing nonconformity, and we don't see one here. And the nonconformity is the encroachment into the setback. So that's not at issue here. They're not encroaching any further into the 20-foot setback, such that we wouldn't have to go into that additional discussion. And, you know, I think it is, you know, in the substantially, you know, not substantially more detrimental analysis, I think I echo what you said. It's an improvement.
Yes, within the neighborhood.
It's consistent.
Yeah.
It's not a gaudy addition that would cause, well, that would not add to the curb appeal.
Right.
So those are my comments. At this point in time, I'm going to open the meeting up for any public comment. If there are any members of the public that would like to speak on behalf of this case, please rise, identify yourself and your address, and speak a piece.
You can come up, you can stand up and speak against it too if you wish. It's not only in favor of.
Oh, did I say in favor?
Be opposed to.
Speak on the case. All right, hearing none. We'll close the public portion of the case and move forward to any further board commentary. None? Somebody like to make a motion?
I'll make the motion.
Thank you, Eric.
I move to approve the petition of Lee Sullivan and Christine Sullivan, who seek a special permit under section 7.3.2, in order to construct a front entrance with a roof over it, 4.2 feet by 9.2 feet, as depicted on a certified plot plan prepared by Cavanaro Consulting, 687 Main Street, Norwell, Mass. Stamped by Brendan P. Sullivan, professional land surveyor, dated February 5th, 2016, and an architectural plan prepared by Ablis and Associates Architects, Inc., South Natick, Mass., prepared for EH Construction Company, 25 Pond Brook Circle, Weston, Mass., dated February 5th, 2016. Further move that the board make a finding that such alteration and structural change is not substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood than the existing non-conforming building or structure, and that no additional impact to the front setback is present, and so no variance is required. I will take a stab at some conditions. Special permit is conditioned upon the following. Petitioner shall submit to the building inspector a certified plot plan of the proposed construction prior to the issuance of a building permit for the work. Petitioner's final construction plans for the new structure shall be submitted to the building inspector prior to the issuance of a building permit. Petitioner's as-built plans shall be submitted to the building inspector, showing the completed construction immediately after the work. Petitioner shall obtain final minor project sign-off from the Conservation Commissioner. And no additional platform shall be added to the front structure, and no future enclosure of the portico shall be permitted. How's everyone like that?
Sounds good.
Okay.
Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Kathy? Any further discussion by board members regarding the motion on the table? Hearing none, we'll move to a vote. All those in favor?
Do you want to vote on this one, Nick?
Sure. Any opposed? Hearing none, the permit is granted. Thank you very much. I'm going to stamp some plans for you, and you can take those with you to accompany the board's decision when it's filed. Give me a minute. The appeal period runs 20 days.
It is, yeah.
Thanks. All right.
We have extra set in the bottom of
I think we've got the plans. And I don't have an extra one. Do I need one? There's already one in there.
Okay.
Yeah, there's already one in there. Let me just scan the file. So I'm going to step away, leave you this evening. Cy Cowett will chair the next case. You ought to probably explain to the petitioner what the composition of the board means now that there'll be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all remaining members will be voting members.
Yeah.
Thanks very much.
Thank you, David.
Thanks. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Okay, the last case before us this evening is case 16-07, and I'll read the public notice. Public hearing in the selectmen will be held in the selectmen's meeting room at the town hall at 16 Lowell Street, Reading. Tonight, April 7th, and the petition of Chris Barsikowski, who seeks a special permit under section 732 of the zoning bylaw in order to construct a front farmer's porch and a rear deck which encroaches into the side yard setback to 15 feet on the property located at 27 Woodward Avenue in Reading. Unless there's an objection, I will dispense with the reading of the abutters list. I was going to say they've all been notified, as have been the Board of Selectmen, the various departments and commissions in the town of Reading, as well as the planning boards of all the local communities. Testimony given before this board, as you've heard tonight, was taken under oath, so anyone who wants to speak on this case this evening, would you please stand up at this time and raise your right hand and swear that the testimony you give before this board is the truth,
doesn't,
the whole
it
truth.
Doesn't hurt. And that way you can always speak.
And if you don't talk, you're ready to do it, okay?
Sure.
The answer is I do.
I do.
Okay. I assume you're Mr. Barsikowski, so we'll let you take the floor and tell us what you're planning to do or would like to do.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Chris Barsikowski, and this is my wife, Lori Barsikowski. We purchased the property at 27 Woodward Ave back in December of last year. The property needs some renovations, so we started planning our renovations, working closely with our drafter. Upon receiving our certified plot plan, we realized that the right side of the house encroaches into that 15-foot setback in the S-15 zone. On our plot plan, we have the proposed deck. Basically, we're looking to build a rear deck and a front porch off of the right side of the house, which is that 4'2" section, which gets us to that 15-foot setback. We've looked at the house numerous times and spent a lot of time with our drafter trying to maintain the character of the house. It seemed like it fit the neighborhood very well. We didn't want to change the Dutch colonial look. But we are encroaching into that 15-foot setback with the rear deck and the front porch. So we are seeking a special permit to construct the 4'2" section on the right side of the house on the farmer's porch and the rear deck. We have been issued a building permit by Glenn, so we have started with some work, but we have not done anything with the rear deck and the front porch.
That's it?
That's it.
Thank you very much.
We handed out a couple extra pieces of paperwork that actually highlight the sections of the farmer's porch and the rear deck that's encroaching into that.
Less of an eye strain than we've got.
A little bit.
Yeah.
I also have a full set if anybody would like to take a look at a bigger set of drawings.
Thank you. Okay. I'll open it up for board discussion. I'll go back to the left-hand side of the table. I'll start with you, Kathy.
So I have been by, so I've noticed that you have started the construction. Yeah. But you haven't started, you said, on the points, obviously, that are an issue in here.
On the right side.
So I guess my question is, I know you're adding the porch, you want to add the porch and the deck. Those are not encroaching any more than the rest of the house at this time.
No, the existing house was illegal non-conforming, so we're
maintaining
the existing line of the house, if you will, and we're just basically extending the back in the front by 5 feet in the front of the farmer's porch and 20 feet in the rear.
And if you know the neighbor there, how do they feel about this? Are you
Mr. John Walsh is actually here with us tonight. I have mentioned it to the neighbors.
So you don't, that's fine. All right. Right now, that's all I have, but.
Okay, John, any comment?
Well, actually, seeing that the neighbor is here, and he maybe would like to speak to that. I truly looked at the property, and it's kind of tight down there. That's the major reason. This does have an impact on the neighborhood, which is a little bit different than it has been in some of the other cases we've had. So I'll just leave it at that point for now.
Okay.
Eric?
Well, we're under the same portion of the bylaws that we were on the last case, which again says that one of the factors to consider is it going to be, you know, substantially more detrimental than what you have here. And what you're asking to do is to extend an existing non-conformance. I can see here on the architectural plan you just submitted, they have a very nice 15 setback line drip all the way through the house. So it looks like the playroom and dining room are already, I guess, offending that required setback. But I do think John has a point that the actual amount that you are extending it and the nature that you are extending it does add to the mass of the house. I'd be interested to see, you know, the public comment portion of this before I really, I guess, make up my mind. But I do think that the overall look of the house is very attractive. I mean, the front porch here, I mean, I think that's, you know, classic New England. So I will just, I guess, hold back any final thoughts until the public portion.
Okay. Nick, do you have any comments?
Yeah, I actually have a question. The deck that you're proposing, is it a raised deck? And if so, how much off the ground is it?
It's going to be roughly about 4 feet above
the ground. Okay. Is there any existing privacy fencing or screening separating the abutter?
There are shrubs. There is no stocking fence. There is shrubbery.
On the surface, my sense is I agree that it's not going to be conforming. It's going to be conforming with the rest of the property line, but given the nature, it's it may impede on the abutter's sense of privacy at the moment. So I'd just be curious to what the abutter's comments would be on this.
That's it?
Yeah.
Okay. In my looking at it, you know, and I went by and looked at the property too, you are well underway. on the rest of it. But in looking at what's before the board tonight, I see that you're basically extending a non-conformity, but in my view, you're not really creating a new one, which obviously would require a variance. I'm going to read into the record at this time, the building inspector's comment on this. He indicates that the proposal was to construct a rear deck and a front porch that does not comply with the required side yard setback, and a special permit is required by the ZBA in order to maintain the existing setback of 10.8 feet. So he's not talking about any variance here. He's talking about strictly a special permit because what you're doing is extending but not creating. So that's the only comment I have at this time, and I think what I'd like to do is open it up for public comment at this time. And we really, I think, as you've heard around the table, would like to hear from the abutters and their feelings about this project. So it's opened up, and I look forward to hearing from you. Did you get sworn in?
No.
Did you get sworn in before? Would you please stand up then? The testimony I'm about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Okay. Please identify yourself when you speak.
I'm May Mascarello, and I live at 15 Woodward Ave.
Okay.
And I grew up in this house that you're doing.
In the house you're talking about here? Ooh.
And I'm Kathy Dunn, and I live right behind this house. And I also grew up in that house.
We're sisters.
And I live on 17 Bill.
You're what? Sisters?
We're sisters.
Oh, okay.
So anyways, I live on 17 Bill Road. I'm right behind the property. His property and their property. I have a lot.
Don't tell me you're a brother.
Okay. We don't have any boys.
Okay.
John
yes.
Walsh, I live at 25 Woodward Avenue.
Okay.
I'm the abutter on the right side.
And what's your feeling about the project?
The deck is all I can think of. It's looking good, but as far as noise level, that was I was concerned with.
Okay. What's your reaction to that, Mr. Barnes? Yes.
My reaction is we're well into our mid-30s. I don't think we're going to be having any parties, maybe an occasional summer cookout once or twice a year. I work very early in the morning. I'm usually in bed by 8 o'clock. We have two young children. Again, they're, you know, in bed by 6:30, 7 o'clock. I think that part of our life has kind of been left in the past already. I think we're just looking to settle down, and we found a great neighborhood and, you know, a great place to raise our kids. And we really, you know, enjoy spending, you know, summers, you know, playing with the kids in the backyard or on the deck and just enjoying the neighborhood.
Okay.
And from my perspective, it is, you mentioned privacy, right? So my lot is right behind, my house is lot 301 on there or whatever. So, yes,
yeah.
301. So it's a 13,000 foot square lot or whatever. And my house is on one side of it, then I have an empty lot, which is pretty much where the house is on 27 Woodward. It faces my empty lot. So I am concerned a little bit about the deck, but I talked to Chris and, you know, it's only going to be 4 feet. It's not going to be really pushing out. We have bushes. We can landscape. I don't see any problem with it at all. They're a great family. Their children are great, and I just love them. And I'm very happy that we have a family like that living in the house that we grew up in. So I think I'm...
How does Sis feel about this?
Well, she doesn't have anything to say. She's way down the street. And I think the front porch will look gorgeous on
yeah.
the house. We're really excited to see the house get
revamped,
enhanced, and have a new family live in it. It's, you know,
we were both concerned about the deck coming back too far, having it so high. There is a family next to Kathy's house that they're in a screened-in porch. They're up high. They have a built-in pool, and they're very noisy. So, but they're up high, and so their voices go all through the neighborhood when they have parties and whatever. But so we were a little concerned about that. I know the variance that we're talking about is a problem, but as you saw, my mother's dining room and kitchen were already off code. When we were growing up, I guess we were in Wawa. But so that, you know, the fact that they're bringing it out and it's coming close to his property is far back from actually John's home. It's John's home is, everything he does is off to the other side. So, and I also love the porch. I think that porch, if he could get that porch, it would be awesome.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
We love that front porch.
Is there any particular reason why you opted for a 20-foot length on that side?
For the rear deck?
Yeah. I mean, that is a good size.
Yeah. I mean, I think just thinking about maybe, you know, putting a table out there and eating dinner in the afternoons. And I think from what the neighbors tell us, the mosquitoes are brutal out there. So
I'm telling them, like, screen them.
I'm not sure if we'll get to use it, but just to have, you know, have room out there to you know, to move around.
I drove by there, but I didn't really observe as accurately as I should have. Is there any trees or shrubbery along that side between their property and yours?
There used to be a tree, a big tree there, and it had to be taken down. So the big tree is taken down. So now it's wide open from my house to, you know, my view is, I can see, but it's the same view that I see with John, you know, John Walsh's. I can look out my kitchen window and wave to him in their kitchen window. So, you know, it's the same thing. And again, we talked about, you know, we'll put a tree in there, or I do have bushes. I think they're yours, but I don't know whose bushes they are. But there's a set of bushes there that separate my extra lot with their house lot. And again, I have trees. You know, I think I can work with the privacy. I can work with them. I mean,
okay.
Yeah.
Any other comments?
They're great.
Okay. Good. As you, I'm sure, understand, we're here to basically enforce the zoning laws of the town of Reading. And we look at these things from the standpoint of compliance with those laws and what's required to do so. But we do like to hear how neighbors feel about these kinds of questions too. So we thank you for that input. And I'll close the public portion of the meeting at this time. Any other comments, further comments from the board?
Just a point of order, Mr. Chairman. I
yes.
don't know if we want to go on record as to the vote requirement and consequences of the vote.
the vote that is taken to approve the project, you have to have 4 out of 5 affirmative votes. And there will be 5 voting members tonight, the 5 that you see left here tonight. So 4 out of 5 of us have to approve this project. And if it's approved, fine. If it's not approved, then I think it's basically you got to go back. You got to wait for a certain period of time before you can do it again.
Well, we closed the public hearing aspect of it, but maybe there is some adjustment that can be made here. Two, if that's the case, then you wouldn't have to come back if the board agrees to whatever the adjustment is on the proposal. So, I mean, we still have some options. For example, I think there's 2 points in my mind that come up. Number one, if this were granted as it is now, we're not granting it for you. We're granting it for all eternity type of thing. So it's you and your predecessors and the predecessors of the people who own the back property, like your sister, well, one of the sisters and Mr. Woodward. So that in itself is a situation. Right now, the deck is not included as living space. You enclose it, it becomes living space. So that changes the whole dimension of what you're asking for. So when you go back to see the building inspector and you want to enclose it, you may, if you're thinking about that, you may be told, I'm sorry, you can't do that because unless you get a variance, you run the numbers already and you're over. I didn't actually calculate the numbers. That's one issue in my mind. The second question I have, I believe that the farmer's porch out front makes the house, definitely, again, using streetscape, since that's a big issue here in town. And I can't say that I'm not in favor of that either. But the back deck is 14 by 20. If you comply with the 15-foot setback on the back deck, it reduces the back deck to 10 feet by 20 feet. Actually, that's not quite right. It becomes 9.10 inches by 20 feet because we're taking off the 5 feet from the setback, which is right now where I have it. It's 10. With that, it would be 10.8 feet. Yeah. So, or 10 feet 8 inches. So we're not really talking about a major. And we haven't done this before because the two have been grouped together, but there's no reason why we can't approve one and not approve the other. So I'm just throwing that out there and seeing where it's at.
One of the features that we've added to the house was coming out to the deck. We added a double wide slider from the dining room onto the deck. I think we're just, of course, it's into the 15-foot setback, but it's would complete the look from the inside of the house.
Which, again, can be adjusted. It's minor in that respect. If the 4.2, in essence, which is the encroachment, is lopped off of that. But I just throw that out there. I don't know how, shouldn't say you guys, but I mean the owner, because you're the one presenting the proposal, react to that. I think this is a little bit, because it's a little bit different from the rest of the neighborhood. The neighborhood is somewhat impacted by this, and it was Mr. Woodward's, Mr. Walter's house, and actually, the one behind it, which is
Miss Dunn's.
Yep. The others, it would be difficult to do anything like this because of the neighborhood, because the only one that would have no problem with it probably would be either lot 284 or 283. In that square rectangular, actually not even a rectangle, it's a rectangle, I guess. But let me just leave it lay there and see what how other people on the board think or what the petitioners are looking at.
What's just one quick question before I turn it over to Kathy. The existing two-story building, what is that dimension between the proposed deck and the proposed porch? What is that like?
The depth of the existing
house. Of the existing house.
44 feet deep.
So the deck is almost as big as the width of that house on that side. Okay, Kathy, comment?
I have no problem with on the front of the house. I do have questions with the size of the deck, and in specifically in terms of the bylaw, it talks about not being substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood, and I do think there are some concerns, which gives me pause on this. But I don't know what to recommend as to the best way to proceed on this, but that's what my thought is right now.
Any further other comments?
Yeah, my only comment, and this is more of internal thinking, is whatever potential detriment a conforming deck might have, I don't see how a non-conforming deck would have any more detriment. That's just only my thoughts to it.
Yeah, the concerns that I've heard expressed from the neighbors is that perhaps the noise potential, mm-hmm. whether the deck is 20 feet or 10 feet, I don't think that would necessarily alter that concern, okay? I don't think it will change it at all. So the concern about the size of the deck dimensionally to the neighbors doesn't sound like it's a concern. At least that's what I've heard, okay? And in terms of conformance with the bylaws, whether it's 20 or 10 or 15, or whether it's pulled in a little bit so that it's not the 10.8, it's something more than that, doesn't alter things in my mind, okay? So, but I just caution you that you need 4 out of 5 affirmative votes on this board for your proposal to pass. And if you feel it's a sense that you might not be able to get that, then there are some options to you. You could continue this to another time and look at how you might alter this thing and come back. All right? And if you decide to just go with the vote tonight, whatever it may be, and I don't know at this point what it might be, then you're locked in if it's a negative vote for how long, John?
3 years.
It's 2 years? Yeah, you can't come back again. 2 years to do it again, right?
Well, 2 years on a variance, special permit, I suppose if they were to change one dimension, they could actually come back within a very short period of time.
But they have to reapply.
Yeah.
They'd have to reapply. So,
I think Mr. Coquette said is whether the size of the deck is 10 or 20, the noise impact, I think it's, I can stress again that I think we're kind of, beyond that point in our life. I think we would be, we'd be open to shrinking that deck down. We would really like to maintain that 10'8". In line with the existing structure due to the architectural features of the house, again emphasizing on the Dutch colonial look, we could definitely, if it becomes a question of that 20 feet, I think we'd definitely be open to maybe pulling that in a little bit to make the zoning board approve it. I don't know if
just say, go back to the board one more time and say, okay, from the standpoint of your, those who may be concerned about this thing or those who are not uncomfortable with it, is the main thing that bothers any one of us the length of the deck, the height of the deck, the width of the deck? Because it's hard for us to sit here and pass recommendations to you as to what might be acceptable, okay? I mean, we're not in the business of defining how you're going to construct your deck. We just review what you propose,
right,
and act on it. So, is there any other comment from the board before, yeah?
My only comment would be, you said the deck might be 4 to 5 feet high. And I know the current neighbor is okay with it, but my concern would be the future neighbors who may want more privacy or would put up a fence, that if you were to entertain or someone were to entertain that deck, you might be overviewing the fence into their property line. And have you considered a patio?
We have thought of it. Yes. Like the idea of a deck. Again, you know, patio is an option. There are some neighbors higher than us, behind us with the pool that, you know, they have a deck that basically overlooks their backyard. And, you know, basically, I mean, when we came to buy the house, it was, I mean, you know, with the house, you know, it is what it is. We can't change the neighbors at the point of buying the house, and we either accept it or we keep looking. And we kind of just fell in love with the neighborhood, and coming off about, we were on Main Street for about 12 years, and after last year's snowstorm with the 9-foot snowbanks and my wife pulling out onto Main Street with 12 kids in the house, we said, you know, basically we can't do this anymore. And it's a tough market in Reading, as I'm sure all of you know. So it took us some time to find this house and to find this neighborhood. And I think from our viewpoint, when we were discussing buying the house, I don't think, you know, something like, you know, if the neighbor's porch is higher, you know, it didn't deter us from making our decision. So I think, we basically accepted that, you know, we love the neighborhood, and we actually took our kids trick-or-treating there for Halloween, and we couldn't believe how quiet it was coming off of Main Street. So we knew we made the right choice, and accepted, the neighborhood and the other houses around there.
Well, the concern that I have is pretty much echoed, I mentioned before, Nick brought up again, and that is, it's not decisions made by the board is not a plebiscite of the neighborhood, is not a plebiscite of the neighbors. It's the character of the neighborhood, and we're talking about future owners, because that's what zoning is. Once you establish a zone and you permit something, it's not always going to be that way, because you can always go back and rebuild in that respect. Hearing what Kathy has said, and the concern that I have for the front porch, the farmer's porch, not at all. And I'm not sure, I don't think anybody else has a problem with it. It really is a rear deck. So I can see perhaps two options to go. One is to separate the two and take two votes. Or, which I think would allow you some time, you may want to think about this and ask for continuation and come back and see if you want to adjust maybe the rear deck aspect of it. You have no dimensions, so it's very difficult for us to look. Other than the side dimension, which I can see maintaining the setback of the 15 feet, but if you wanted to do, instead of the 20-foot deck deep, cut it off in line with perhaps the addition that you're putting on, that shortens the deck, I'm guessing, by about 6 feet, but I don't know that. There's no dimensions, so instead of being 14 by 20, it'd be 14 by 14.
I think the rear addition is 12 feet. coming out in the back.
And you have plenty of room to put your stairs coming off the deck to the rear. That's not an issue. But I mean, at this point, unless we have, if that were an option, either way, and you were cutting down the 20-foot depth, maybe it's an option. But if you want to go forward and submit that, you'd have to have the dimensions before we do that. We couldn't give you okay until we can do that, which means that you would have to submit a modification to what you have here on the deck aspect of it.
Would that go through the same process as this?
Again, two options. You can continue the subject matter of this hearing to a date certain forward. I don't know what we have on the docket now.
We're in June now. So the first week in June.
The 21st, May.
May 12th is the 40B.
Yeah.
Well, and then another one would be, that's already booked. I think that's one of the four now. We'll be in June.
Well, we have one case on the 21st, right?
You know what? I don't know. I just know that there's a real conversation.
I think there's only one.
Only
I think
one
there's only
case
one.
On the
21st.
Yeah.
I could be wrong.
Which would give you, in essence, 2 weeks.
You're shaking your head.
I don't know.
Oh. Well, that's what we have on our docket. There's only one case.
Just one. See the applicant.
Because the other person who was on that docket for the 21st has now changed.
Has not changed.
And
yeah.
Now it's in May.
Okay.
So there's.
Right. A 2 week.
So there's only one on.
Right.
On the 21st of April.
So that would be a quick turnaround for you if you wanted to do that. Otherwise, if you wanted to move forward, we have to make a decision unless you modify the decision in some way this evening.
Now, as part of a board discussion, I just would like to just reiterate my own thinking for the board members is that, and I correct me if I'm expressing myself in your mind incorrectly, but in terms of strict compliance with the zoning laws, the length of 20 feet, I don't think violates that.
No, not on the, but there's two criteria in there.
I understand.
And it's the neighborhood that I think
right.
Everybody has mentioned.
Right.
But in terms
and your concern is not the immediate neighborhood, but the potential future.
Well, it's always the future. You always have to look at
okay.
the future. It's
yeah.
never as it stands now.
But the thing that we're not, the thing I feel bad about in terms of the petitioner is that if he comes back with a 15-foot instead of a 20-foot, I don't see how that necessarily alters anything. Okay? We're going to be sitting here arguing the same thing, only we're talking about 15 instead of 20. Or if he does 10 feet. The same issue is there, okay? I would certainly acknowledge that the deck as it's currently sized seems out of proportion with the main house. It does seem that way, okay?
I think that's coming
but
from a recent house that we saw.
In terms of impact, the kind of discussion that we're having, in terms of impact on what we've talked about, whether it's 20 or 16 or 15 or 12, I'm not sure that alters that discussion. So
it doesn't my mind.
Okay. So, any other comment to what I just said?
No, I agree with you, Si. I think everyone's trying to balance the, is it, substantially
right.
more detrimental to the neighborhood?
Right.
And
right.
I feel like there's probably a break of opinion
right.
among the board. I mean,
right.
I just thought I'll throw my hat and say, I think that it is a good sized deck. My personal feeling and the way that I would lean towards voting would be to approve it. I don't see it as substantially more detrimental. I don't see, unless you were to shrink back the setback and kind of reconfigure it so that you could get it by right, I'm not sure that there's anything that the petitioner could do in at least in my mind, that would make it any less detrimental. You know, whether it's the height or whether it's the length. I mean, the fact that the deck is there at all is going to create, you know, an outdoor space where people next to the lot, you know, are going to hear it and see it. So if it was, you know, I mean, if it was like an obnoxious amount, like 50 feet wide or 50 feet long, then yeah. But I mean, it's within the character. I mean, it's not, I mean, I don't see it as out of proportion with the scale of the project. I mean, it is a massive renovation. But I mean, that's my opinion. I mean, other people on the board have different ones.
I'm just trying to get everything on the table before we take it.
I think one thing, the special permit, again, is within the setbacks of the rear property lines. So I think the issue of 20 feet, I think it's still within the setbacks.
Right.
It's that 4.2-foot section on the right side of the property due to the existing non-conforming structure.
I mean, no matter what you decide, okay, I mean, you could, even though you say you don't, you may move next year, and you get a really wild and crazy neighbor that's going to really, you're going to wish you never did it, the neighbors will, okay? I mean, we don't know what the future brings, okay? And we're just dealing with the situation at the moment, what you've asked for. And just trying to explore possible ways in which we can make an intelligent decision that works, or give you some guidance in terms of what you might do for options. Okay, I mean, there's no dispute around the table that the farmer's porch. I haven't heard anybody say it's not. It's a great addition. Okay, and it really enhances the front of the house. And it's just a concern about the size of the porch behind it. So. Is there any other comments from the board before I entertain a motion?
Well, you want to go forward with exactly what you have right now, right?
I would like to maybe do two votes if that's possible for the farmer's porch.
I didn't hear that.
Two votes for the...
You want to separate the two?
You want to separate the
correct,
two?
Yeah, so I mean, the farmer's porch seems like it's there's no issues with that, so we'd like
We could do that, and separate that, and vote on that, and we could ask you for if you want to do a continuance on the rear deck so that you can think about it a little more and come back. Okay? We're open on the... We could still do two votes.
Sure, yeah.
We could vote on the porch, that's approved. Fine. And then we do a vote on the other one. If that's disapproved, then you're faced with some sort of a change.
And the votes, is it four votes, four yes votes? Or
4 out of 5 have to approve, yes.
If somebody doesn't vote, does that...
Hmm?
If one of the members doesn't vote, does that...
They could abstain. Yeah, I suppose they could abstain. Yeah. But you still need four votes.
Okay.
Four positive votes.
And then if we don't get the vote, is that if we vote on the rear deck, is that 2 years before I can reapply?
No, you can come in with a change.
Yeah.
Okay.
You could make
down
a change and come in.
Okay. I think I'd like to vote on the vote. The
okay.
Farmer's porch and the rear deck.
As it stands. Just separate the front farmer's porch from the rear deck.
Sure. And if the rear deck doesn't pass, if we vote on it, can I come back with a change? And
in
2 weeks.
And we do.
Huh? I think you need to republish
it
if it was a negative
yes.
vote.
You'd have to go through
it's
the
a negative
process.
Vote. You've got to go through the application process.
So we can't come back in 2 weeks.
No.
You could if you continued it, though.
If you
want to just continue the second
that.
Part.
Yeah.
That's right. If you're in the middle of your reconstruction now, or construction now, I can't recommend, but I'm going to say that if I were sitting on the other side, the 2 week is not going to make a big difference to come back because you're still going to, it's all going to ultimately only delays you 2 weeks.
Right. Yeah.
If you take a vote, you have to start from scratch again.
Right.
the starting from scratch will cost you, two and a half, almost 3 months.
Yeah.
So do we have to send the letters again?
Oh,
yep.
Start
for
off?
The two, for to come back in 2 weeks?
No.
No,
no, we'll just continue it. We'll
you would take this that you've handed out, and if you wanted to modify that in some respects and you want to come back in 2 weeks, we can do that.
We would need a formal modification.
Sure. I understand. I think my concern is, where do we go?
Yeah.
How do we modify it?
That's the thing that bothers me.
Right.
Okay, I mean, I'd like to send you away with.
Like you said, we'll be here in 2 weeks having the same conversation.
But if you came back in 2 weeks, I got a 15-foot deck instead of a 20 deck. I mean, I don't know where that takes us.
I mean, if the question here is noise level, what's the difference from the noise level on a deck to down on like the lower level grass area? What's the difference? I mean, we have children who are going to be on a swing set playing down below. If anything, we'll just be eating lunch and dinner up there.
The question is, if you're going to modify it, there's only two ways to modify it. One is by the setback from the side yard property line, or the depth of the deck, the 20 feet withdrawn. The easiest by right is to just take off the 4.2 feet, because by right you have that. You can do that now. You can go back into the building inspector and say, hey, look at... we opted not to go that route. We're going to cut 4.2 feet off, and you're golden. I know you want the 4.2 feet on the front, the farmer's porch, which I don't think any of the board members have a concern about, because it makes the addition. It makes the house.
I do agree with that, but it's still, you know, to our lifestyle and our life and our kids, that the rear deck is going to make the house. As the farmer's porch is gonna, you know, give it the curb appeal and give it that nice look that we're trying to maintain at the time.
Well, you don't have a curb appeal back there. I mean, the only curb appeal is to your neighbors. And we're talking about neighbors now and in the future.
True.
Another option that Nick has brought up, or he hasn't actually said it, but that is the buffering on the side in the form of, it could be fencing, it could be and fencing does not necessarily mean a formal fence,
sure,
because anything over 6 feet you have to have a permit for anyways. But certainly there is, plantings, trees, not arborvitae, because that's too low. But I mean, you could do a certain... not foliage, but landscaping means of buffering in the back, which, again, it's not necessarily needed for your neighbors now, but it would be necessary for the neighbors perhaps in the future. And having sat the number of years that I have on the board, I'm very appreciative of time, because you see some of these things that... originally start out as one thing, and they just seem to grow. And then you have a neighborhood which is no longer a neighborhood which it was supposed to be. And then when people come in to amend things, they need variances. And this board does not look very well on variances, at least this sitting board. I don't know what the future board will do. So
have you ever considered, maybe, as John says, bringing that 14-foot thing into compliance with the setback? But then, I'm saying this, which is a new idea, that's all, extending the 20 to go back and then come over to the left and just making it bigger that way.
I'd have to speak to that.
Huh?
Yeah.
You would what?
I said I'd want to speak on that one. So that's wrapping the deck around the new addition.
It is.
That is something I would have an issue with.
Okay. All
But
they could do that by right.
But by right, they can do that.
But by right, they could do it. That's right. They could do it, and they could make a the bigger deck they like, but just it's just shaped differently. Okay, I mean that's just another thought.
I think you know part of when we bought the house, there was a detached garage, which again was a non-conforming structure that we removed because it was 50 feet away from the rear property line. So I know we're still encroaching, but we have taken down existing structures that were non-conforming to make the lot and the structures on it more conforming than it was when we bought the purchased the property.
Right. Well, the shed is still there, right?
The shed, but there was a detached single car garage on the property.
Oh, the shed was a single car garage?
No, the shed was there, but when we bought the property, there was a detached single car garage.
Yes,
almost
where,
in the
where one of your
proposed
construction
setback.
Is. Yeah.
So we have done things to make it more conforming. Again, the deck, we're not encroaching into the property line. We're within our property line on the rear, the 20-foot setback. Again, it's...
One last question. When is your current building project scheduled to be completed?
Well, we're currently renting an apartment, and our lease ends at the end of July. So we are really hoping not to have to extend the lease because the cost of renting and mortgage is...
The only reason I ask that question is that if you were to take a vote and it would agree, and the zoning board did not approve the deck, okay, then you'd have to reapply, okay? But that puts the case being reviewed in June, still before the completion of your overall project. So
yeah, right, yeah.
It still could you still could probably pull in whatever deck might you want to go to within that schedule. Okay?
I think if you know if it comes to that and that is the case, I think we would construct the mirror deck without that 4'2" setback and go through that process again, and in hopes that. You know, it would pass.
Okay. Well, if you come back with if you come back and you comply with the setback of the 15 feet, it's by right. You don't have to come back here.
Agreed, yes. But if we do take the vote, which I believe we're going to be leaning towards taking the vote on the very day today, if it doesn't go through and we have to go through the process again, time-wise, if it's June or July, we would basically have to build a deck to get a certificate of occupancy without the, you know, without the set, without that.
You could put a, yeah, you're right, you could put
correct.
A deck,
a
you could put a deck on.
A conforming structure, correct. It's
conforming, but as you said, you wanted a double wide slider in the back, which you couldn't put in. That's part of your construction now. That's part of the new construction. So
right.
You want to,
it's
just going to be increasing the cost of the proposed construction, which is an addition.
Agreed.
Well, I don't want to drag on the conversation
yes.
Much longer, okay? Just to try to summarize it, you have choices. We could split the vote. We could split the motion. We have a motion to approve or to act on a decision on the farmer's porch, and then we could have a separate motion to act on the rear deck, approval of the rear deck for as it's configured now. And if we approve it, wonderful. If we don't approve the rear deck, then you're faced with coming back with a new application and proposal.
Yes.
But that would put you into June, okay, for that. So that's the option. And I guess, are you saying you want to have a vote on both this evening?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Any further comment before I ask for a motion?
Well, the applicant, you officially requesting that the we take two votes then? At this point?
Yes.
Okay. One on the front farmer's porch and one on the rear deck.
I'll entertain a motion first on the farmer's porch. Anyone would like to make that motion? As the chair, I guess I'm not supposed to. Right?
Can make it.
Okay.
I move to, well, actually, I guess, do we have to move to bifurcate it, or is that just something we can just do on our own?
What, to what?
To bifurcate the vote. Do I have to, like, move to, you know, accept the petitioner's motion to bifurcate the vote?
Oh.
Because if I do, I just did it, and anyone who wants to second it.
I guess we probably have to
I'll
do
that.
That's good.
I'll second his motion to bifurcate it.
Yeah.
Perfect. All right.
Yeah.
So I move to approve the petitioner's request for a special permit under section 7.3.2 in order to construct a front farmer's porch which encroaches into the side setback of 15 feet at the property located at 27 Woodward Ave, Reading, Massachusetts, as depicted on a certified plot plan prepared by Land Mapping Inc., 10 Andrew Square, Suite 210D, South Boston, Mass., 02127, stamped by Patrick Rosengrave, professional land surveyor, dated March 12th, 2016. I also reference the architectural plan prepared by JustDrawIt.com, 133B Main Street, North Reading, Mass. And I further move that the board make a finding that such alteration and extension of the nonconformity will not be substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood than the existing nonconforming building or structure. Special permit is conditioned upon the following. I'm assuming with porches we have foundational plans. Okay.
Yeah.
We do, yes.
Perfect. I'll have the three standard ones then. Petitioner shall submit to the building inspector a certified plot plan of the proposed construction and proposed foundational plans prior to the issuance of a foundational permit for the work. Petitioner's final construction plans for the new structure shall be submitted to the building inspector along with the as-built foundation plans prior to the issuance of a building permit, and the petitioner shall submit as-built plans to the building inspector showing the completed construction immediately after the work is completed and prior to the issuance of an occupancy permit.
Is that okay with everybody?
Yeah. I'll second the motion.
Yep.
Yep.
All in favor? 500. That's approved. Now I'll entertain a motion for the deck.
Sure.
I hate to give you guys two tonight.
No, that's
not worth
it. I'm enjoying it. Okay.
I move to approve the petition of Chris Barkakowski, who seeks a special permit under section 7.3.2 of the zoning bylaws in order to construct a rear deck which encroaches into the side yard setback of 15 feet on the property located at 27 Woodward Avenue in Reading, Massachusetts, as depicted on the certified plot plan prepared by Land Mapping Inc., 10 Andrews Square, Suite 201B, South Boston, Mass., and stamped by Patrick Rosengrave, land surveyor. And also reference the architectural plans prepared by JustDrawIt.com, 133 Main Street, North Reading, Mass. And we would put the conditions, correct?
Yeah.
For the deck, the regular conditions as
I
well.
I would say the regular
yeah.
conditions of the plot tattoos.
Yeah, subject to the following three conditions.
Okay.
The petitioner shall submit to the building inspector a certified plot plan of the proposed construction and proposed foundation plans prior to the issuance of a foundation permit for the work. The petitioner's final construction plans for the new structure shall be submitted to the building inspector along with the as-built foundation plans prior to the issuance of the building permit, and the as-built plans showing the completed construction shall be submitted to the building inspector immediately after the work is completed and prior to the issuance of the occupancy permit.
I'll second that.
Okay. Everybody understand the vote?
Mm-hmm.
I'll entertain you. All in favor? Opposed? It's not approved.
You have to stamp.
Wait a minute.
You have to stamp the plans.
Yeah, I'll stamp the plans. I guess I should make a note. Farmer's porch, don't I?
Right.
Okay, hold on.
sign?
Huh?
Send it right up to you?
Yeah, yes, send that right up when this case to me, okay?
Okay.
There you go. Sorry it took so long.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I just want to say thank you. I didn't think of it in that respect, like future people. So I'm glad you're pointing that out. Like just the future neighborhood and the future thing, you know, people that might come in the future or whatever. It's not just about me living in the house, that's all.
Okay.
So,
thank
thanks.
You for the comment.
Yeah.
Thank you. I don't think there's anything else on the agenda tonight, so I will entertain a motion to adjourn. Second?
Second that.
Okay. All in favor? 500. Have a good night.
Kim,
hopefully it's not raining anymore.
I know. Kim, is there any way to get the minutes from that before I write my decision? I just want to make sure I write it up.
Oh, woman doesn't have me do the minutes. She doesn't have me do the things. She waits for you guys. She takes over the minutes as soon as I'm done. And she jots down like whatever you guys put.
Okay. Oh, whatever we put.
That's what she puts in there.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, I just do the basic and
she
takes
it
over.
Does she do it from the tape?
I don't care.
Whatever you guys write down.
Yeah, to me ahead of time.
Oh, she doesn't
just
help me write down. Okay.
That's what she told me to do. She goes, no, I'll just take over. Just do motion made by, and then whatever you guys write is what she puts in the minutes.
Well, I don't know if we can address particulars.
Yeah, the decision. I'm sorry. Yeah, the decision. Whatever you write in there.
I didn't say I didn't get this.
Yeah, but I get that all the time. Like, I'll get like the email from Maureen, and I'll say, here's the agenda for this week. And I'll be like, wait a sec, I don't have these. So I'll just very politely email Maureen.
Probably should be given.